It's another beautiful time out on the program, Politics Today. As you know, Politics Today is a news and current affairs program that comes live simultaneously on independent television and radio with a special focus on tackling issues that arise in terms of ensuring that we have a better polity in Nigeria in general, and of course, Edo State and other states as they come. Well, discussing with me, we will be introducing very, very distinguished personalities. But before that, we will be focusing on threads of topics. We're looking at the insecurity issue that is really burning, that's forming national discourse. And just recently, we had the issue of the abduction again of some girls in Zamfara, Jangibi. And that actually is rocking headlines. And looking at the huge number of over 300 girls abducted, it brings to the challenge that we've been having concerning abduction, concerning banditry in the Northwest. We have the issue of the Middle Belt region adding to the list, where we had the Kagara abduction of some boys, where till today we are still amazed about how they will be released. And also the recent one again in Zamfara that really took the abduction of over 300 girls is another challenge. A lot has been said concerning how to tackle this issue, but well, we're stretching the frontiers of this discussion by having distinguished personalities with me, starting from my extreme left. I have a legal practitioner, articulate and erudite, and he was formerly the member of the National Executive Committee of the NBA and former public relations officer, NBA Benin branch, and recently sworn in as the notary public of Nigeria, Ebusele Okifo. Congratulations on your new office.
Thank you very much, Philip. Thank you. Good morning, viewers at home and listeners. Good morning, Philip.
Okay.
Happy to be here.
Yeah, so that means more work for you.
Yeah, more work, more responsibility.
Okay.
You know,
so next to him, I have a political analyst, and he is Idris Zekeri. Thanks for joining me, Idris.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me. And to our viewers and listeners at home, it's a pleasure always to be here.
And I'm your host, Philip Omoh-Gupon. Don't forget that as the show progresses, we will be getting your comments, civil comments, comments from independent television and radio alike, and ensure that you are civil, ensure that your presentation is quite directly to the objectivity of this topic before us. As we dwell on the insecurity issue as a starting point, we also will be turning in to Edo State and recently the issues about governance and Obaseki, where issues concerning the delay in the cabinet formation is taking much dimensions. And also we look at the storm water project in Benin that gobbled 30 billion naira by the previous administration, and a plan of the current state government of Edo State to really probe or look into that and how that is going to pan out. Well, firstly, I will start with you, Ebusele Okifo. Yes. We have this whole issue about the insecurity that is taking us aback. And just recently, the Islamist scholar, Ahmed Gumi, did say that for this issue of insecurity in the Northwest and across the states of the country to be dealt with, there should be amnesty, blanket amnesty, in his words, given to the bandits, which again the presidency refused on that. Mm-hmm. Because the presidency recently said that criminals should be treated as criminals. What are your thoughts along this line and in respect of the recent abduction of the girls in Zamfara?
Well, I feel that first of all, that's an irresponsible talk for you to say you want to grant amnesty to people that have been killing people, people that have been burning down communities, people that have been sacking the whole community, kill them, you know, makes the farmers unable to go to their farms, you know, and they kidnap Nigerians at random, demand for money, kill them in the process, then you say you want to grant them amnesty. So if Gomez feels that because the late president Yar'Adua granted amnesty to militants from the Niger Delta, the two scenarios, you cannot compare them. The Niger Delta militants were not, they were not kidnapping Nigerians. They were not even kidnapping for money. You know, they were agitating for resource control. You understand? They were not constituting that nuisance to the generality of Nigerians, except what they were demanding for. That was why Yar'Adua and I said, okay, let's see what we can do. You know, NDDC was set up.
Okay, so set up was actually a different narrative.
It's a different narrative entirely. You cannot
basis of comparison.
There's no comparison. You cannot be comparing that one, because I'm sure that is why Gomez is saying that.
Kumi.
And it's unfortunate. And it's unfortunate that he's saying that, because right from time, record, if you look at the records, you will see that even while Jonathan was there, he was one of those that was saying that killing of because all these bandits now, most of them, they were Boko Harams. You understand? Before, they are not calling them bandits, giving them different names. He was saying that you don't need to kill them. They are all Northerners, they are Muslim brothers here and there and all that. Suddenly you are not saying a different thing entirely. So that idea will never fly. There should be no amnesty, and I'm sure that's why the federal government, of course, knows that by the time you say that, there will be a problem. It's so unfortunate that, you know, the issue of the kidnapping of the girls, of students, you go into a school, you pack over 300 students, and you move them into the forest.
And the funny thing is, how come?
How do you do that? You go with healers. How many healers are you going to use to evacuate 300 students? And you go into the forest, and nothing is being done.
Okay,
it's unfortunate, because what I say is unfortunate is that we have strong individuals in this country. We don't have strong institutions. If we have strong institutions, why must the security, those heading the various security organs, why must they be holding onto their work at this present situation? Because that's the essence. What do you get paid for? You, as Philip, you get paid for anchoring this program. You get paid for being on air. You get paid, you go out, you put in your reports and all that. By the time you're unable to do that, there's no need for you to be a staff of ITV.
I'll be surplus to requirements.
Yes. So what are the security, what are they doing? You'll be a chief of army staff, you're a commander in one brigade. Then, under your watch, you know, 300 people will just disappear from their school. Nobody knows what's happening. You know, it's an indictment on the security organization. Because we don't have strong institutions, you don't start waiting. You know, you start waiting until something happens before you start taking, you are not proactive. You know, but okay. It's commendable that the National Assembly, they are gradually waking up. And at this point, I want to also commend our representative in the National Assembly, the Senator Matthew Oroide.
Okay.
I watched him yesterday, and he was lamenting that it's bad.
Okay.
Apparently, it was sad that they should move a motion, that a motion should be moved in the National Assembly, comparing the president to do the needful, that he is not calling that President Buhari should be impeached. He's not calling for the removal. But he's saying, let's move a motion to compare him to respect the National Assembly.
Okay,
that motions are passed, you know, resolutions are given. At the end of the day, the president does not even respect the National Assembly. It's unfortunate that it has got it to this stage. Ordinarily, the proper thing for them to have done is to impeach the president. Let whosoever is the next in command take over, then let us see if we'll see respite. Because it's becoming unfortunate where Nigerians, who can't even travel again now. It becomes a problem. Nigerians can't travel. Now everybody, you start looking for air ticket.
I think that would be a bogus statement for you to say.
No, it's not bogus. People cannot travel.
I don't think we have the right panelists to discuss that or to talk about the aspect of impeachment. I think we should lay that to rest for now.
Okay.
Because we need to have the right panelists in that.
We'll take it.
No. I'll come back to you. I'll come back to you. We have been having this whole recurring decima about insecurity and how to tackle it. At one point, there was this plan to rejig the service chief's appointment, sack the current, and then bring another, you know, which later was done. And again, there has been issues about internal security, issues about how the governors should be given more powers in terms of forming a state police structure. We've had these different discussions. Where do you think we've missed it out, or what do you think should be done to arrest this ugly incident? Zachary.
First of all, let me try to give an historical perspective to insecurity as we have seen it in this country. In the time of Obasanjo to Yar'Adua, we had issues with militancy in the Niger Delta.
Yeah.
Then, towards the end of Yar'Adua into President Goodluck Jonathan, we had Boko Haram insurgency. And in this administration, we have had the duo of Boko Haram insurgency on one hand and bandits and militants on another.
On the other hand.
So you see a pattern of violence. Mm. It means that since 1999, no government has deemed it fit, has sat up to the responsibility to end insecurity as it is. And we have continued to trade blames. And the most dangerous part of it all is the ethnic and ethnic coloration that we want to give to criminality. So when something happens, we are looking for where the person who committed the crime comes from, mm. instead of dealing with the crime which that person has committed.
Yeah.
Now, to your question about internal security, our governors have not been responsible enough, and our National Assembly has been irresponsible. There is a difference between the two languages. Now, my co-panelist was talking about. Now, it's not, of course, I'm not learned. I'm not a lawyer.
Well, that could be a prospective one.
Yes, it's in the works. Yeah. Like he was talking about the National Assembly. I think the National Assembly has, is it that they don't know their job, or they are waiting for somebody to teach them their job? The process of lawmaking resides squarely in the hands of the National Assembly.
Okay.
If they have made laws to put state police, and it is now in the table of the president, and the president has refused to sign, then we'll begin to engage the president on the basis of that, that you have a legislation on your table and you have refused to sign it. All crimes are local, and solutions to all crime is local. Hmm. You cannot bring a man from Zamfara to come and tell me who is stealing chicken in my street. He will not know. He does not even understand the language. So I will insist that our governor should do more and talk less. All they do now is when there is a problem, they go on air, they say we are doing this, they have no real control. That is why you see payment of ransom is the order of the day. I don't want to make claims. Payment of ransom in Nigeria now is the order of the day. Because when 300, 400 persons are taken from your state, and these are children of your constituent, children of your state, of people you are governing over, you must make sure that you find a way that those children are returned. And for them to be returned, you go and pay. What are you doing? You are empowering the enemy. Because money makes everything happen. When you give huge amount of money to bandits, what do you expect them to do? They acquire more weapons. Abi, they become more sophisticated. They get more training. It means they are able to do more.
So you are feeding their appetite.
You are feeding their appetite.
That's true.
And there is a very funny video I saw yesterday on social media where a youth said, stop wasting your time writing business proposal. Go and kidnap and negotiate, they will pay you ransom. That is the thinking that we now have in this country. Means if you decide not to break the law, chances are that you will not make it. If you decide to be law-abiding, chances are that you will not make it. But do we continue like this? Of course we cannot continue like this. And that is why the governors must wake up to their responsibility. They collect huge security votes and expect a man in Abuja who does not know Yekori-Omo to come and solve the problem in Yekori-Omo. So they must go down, they must come down from their high horses, they must talk to the president, they must engage on the basis of mutual respect, and let the president know that we want state police. In fact, they are already doing it.
Okay.
Go around, you see vigilante everywhere. Everywhere in the country, go to the east, even here in Edo State, you see vigilante, every street has done vigilante. Is that not state police already? Why not institutionalize it?
But it seems to me that communities are now resorting to self-help.
Yeah. Well, it's not
that's basically
it's
what, not, what we are not, saying.
You cannot.
That's what we're saying.
It is illegal. Self-help. It is illegal to bear arms in this country when you are not given official authority to do it.
Yeah.
So if you see anybody bearing arms and they are not arm robbers, they are not kidnappers, they have been given authority by government to do it.
Yeah.
And that is why you see vigilantes. That's why the vigilantes have approval of the state government. Why not institutionalize state police?
If you say they have approval of the state government to hold firearms, how do we reconcile it with the constitution?
That's where I would disagree with him a little bit.
Okay.
Because you cannot say the governors are doing nothing. You have just acknowledged what the governors are doing by providing vigilante, bringing other security outfits, like those states, for instance. You understand? Yeah.
Authority and hold firearms to bear arms.
Because they have to do that now, because they are also not happy with the situation that their people are being kidnapped, being killed recklessly by bandits. That is why they are doing that. So I feel that the greatest part of the work should be done by the National Assembly, because the issue is that the governor's hands are actually tied. Because security, yes, security is on the exclusive list. You understand? The governor of Obaseki, as well intentioned as he is here, cannot give instruction to the commissioner of police. You understand? If he gives commissioner of police instruction, and a counter instruction comes from Abuja from the IG, the commissioner will refuse. He will do that of the IG.
So there are limitations.
So there are limitations. And how do you take out that limitation?
Okay.
It's for the National Assembly, the House of Reps, and the Senate to amend our laws.
Okay.
To give birth to state police.
We have a very precarious situation.
We cannot do that because they will say the federal government will say this one is on our list. It's on an exclusive list. You cannot do anything. You understand? So the National Assembly, just as you have said, should make a law. Let them make a law saying that there will be state police. You understand? Then the governors can now be able to give directives.
The lawyer will agree with me.
Hey, I agree
that
with
if
you.
Somebody wants to attack you, you have the right to subdue that
defend
person
yourself
and arrest that person and then hand that person over to the police. If you want to do something, if you don't want to do something, you look for an excuse. But if you want to do something, you look for a way. The governors earn huge, humongous security votes. These monies are given to them to keep the peace in their various domains. They can use this money to empower security agents so much so that logistics is not a problem. Have you seen, I don't want to be mentioning names because I like to situate things. Have you gone, even the police station that covers to say, have you seen their trucks? The Elon trucks they use is antiquated, it cannot go anywhere.
Absolutely.
It's obsolete. The car of the criminal runs faster than the car of the police. How will the policeman catch the criminal?
Okay.
So that is the question. Our governors will take it a notch higher. Now, my argument is strictly that you are the governor. The National Assembly members come from your state. Each governor has at least 3 senators from his state. Minimum of 3 senators. Why not talk to these persons and let them know that this is the agenda we want to, this is the legislation. I believe that the governors even need more power so that they can secure. But you see, the idea of trading blames. Your children are not behaving well, you are blaming your neighbor. You say your neighbor is negatively influencing your children. Whereas as a father, you should take charge and make sure you straighten them up. So our governors should wake up. That is not to excuse the big men in Abuja. The big men in Abuja have all the job. But a man cannot sit in the office in Abuja and probably know what is happening. That is why you must now demand for this power. This is a critical curve in our national issue.
Yes, it's a critical curve. And I'll come back to that point you raised, concerning the amnesty issue. But, well, I think we should first get your response, Ebusele Okifo.
Yes.
Now, the situation we have now is precarious.
Yes.
In Niger State, the Kagara issue,
yes,
the abduction of the boys, and then that Zamfara. Of Zamfara,
yes,
in Jangabe,
yes,
the abduction of the girls. Now, the governor, Metawale Bello, did say that they are already negotiating with the bandits. At one point, the president is saying that amnesty can be given.
Yes.
Then at another point, the popular Islamic scholar, Gumi Ahmad, is saying that's the only way to look forward to in terms of tackling this insecurity. Now we have issues.
Them.
We have issues where the state and the federal are at loggerheads in terms of these ideas on tackling insecurity.
Yes.
What do you think should be the way forward
affects
Zamfara and Niger State?
The way forward is for security organization to do their work. Search out these people, make the arrest, prosecute them. Next time, other people will not do it.
Maybe declare an emergency on insecurity.
America as a country don't negotiate with terrorists. Because they know that by the time you start negotiating, then you are not giving them more power. Just as you have said, you are looking for money, you want to settle them for kidnapping innocent school children. You give them this money, they buy more arms, they buy more technological equipment to perfect their crime. You understand? Then they head to the next school where they go and kidnap again so that they have more money.
Okay.
So you don't negotiate with terrorists. The bandits are terrorists.
Okay, but what you just said.
Now, you don't start doing that because you are giving them more power. So the president, the governor, they should be working hand in hand. There should be an agreement between both of them. You understand? Let the security organization, let them fish out these people.
Okay, what I'm saying again is that the president said the federal government should take action beyond words.
Yes.
Because it's one thing to say that, no, we can't grant amnesty, we don't negotiate.
Yes.
But it's another to find a lasting solution to the present issue that they are having in those states.
The lasting solution is for you to look for these people and arrest them, wherever they are. Arrest them. If you know you cannot do it and you need foreign assistance, beg for it, plead for it. You understand? Plead for foreign assistance. Let them come in and help you to solve the situation. Nobody will blame you, because at the end of the day, it's for you to bring the situation under control. You don't start giving money to terrorists, you don't start giving money to bandits, and you expect they will stop. How are they going to stop? Because the next, they will look for the next school and they kidnap the people. Mm. So our leaders should be up and doing.
It's a recurring decimal that we're seeing now. Recurring,
because we see, we see the way, if election is coming in a state now, you see the way they will tell you 30,000 policemen they are in that state. You see that army, they come in, even if they don't participate in the election, they go to the entry point of that state, they make sure nothing happens. What happens to all this situation? What's happened with our policemen? If we say we send 50,000 policemen to Zamfara and Niger State to say, reach out these people, we want them to be out, by all means. Yes, you understand? We remember a situation where this state, then known as Bede State, was under siege by Anini and Co. What did Babangida tell the Inspector General of Police when he came? He said, where is Anini? When the Inspector General of Police then came to welcome me in the airport, the first question he asked was, where is Anini? You understand? And it was a message, it was a clear message to the Inspector General of Police that you cannot be coming to the airport to welcome me while Bede State, they are under siege by a group of criminals. And before you knew it, Anini was fished out. He was caught. You understand? So the president is complacent. That's the truth. Let's not hide away from it. Let's not run away from it. The governors should be up and doing. You understand? They should do all they are supposed to do.
When they say uneasy lies the head that wears the crown, and he who wears the shoe knows where it pinches.
See, that
so
is
you can say that really, the president that is complacent. I don't agree with you on that, because the federal government actually is making its efforts.
I don't have Philip. We do respect, Philip. I don't have any apology for that, because the president came on the matrat of giving us security. It was one of his points.
I got a point.
And it's only on that point.
Okay.
There's an angle we are missing.
You have 2 minutes to round off on that before we go to other issues.
We have two governments working at cross purposes. Mm. The state government now and the federal government.
Yes, of course.
Now, the federal government, by its nature, when there's a kidnapping, their own is to deploy helicopters, soldiers, policemen to the areas where they are kidnapping. The state government, on the other hand, knowing the implication of that, let us paint a scenario. You take 300 students, children who don't have any tactical experience, who have no battle experience, and you are with them in the bush. How will a policeman go and meet you in that bush without killing those children? It presents a dilemma. So the state government, most times, that's why they are quick to want to negotiate. They don't want blood in their hands. Nobody wants blood in his hands. Just the same way that when people are sentenced to death, no governor wants to sign. Nobody wants blood in their hands. So the point here is that the state government must take more responsibility.
Okay.
I'm saying that, and I'm saying that with all sense of certainty.
Okay, thank you.
Let them take more responsibility.
Well, we are still getting reports. We are yet to confirm them tactically and logically. But we're still getting reports that some of the abductees are escaping from the abductors. And the number of that we can't really ascertain for now. But well, in case you're just joining us, it's Politics Today, and the topic is on the issue of insecurity and the abduction of over 300 schoolgirls in Zamfara, Jangebe. And I've been discussing with the legal practitioner, Notary Public, Ebosele Okifo, and also the political analyst, Idris Zekeri. I know you are itching and you are having a very strong appetite to join us in the conversation. And basically, we allow you to really do that in a few minutes from now. But don't forget that for those who want to send their messages to the WhatsApp platform, you use the number 0803-872-6759. 0803-872-6759. I would also appreciate it if it's writing on the screen, so that our viewers on independent television will be able to have a quick capture of the number. 0803-872-6759 for our listeners also on independent radio who would want to send a short message
to the WhatsApp number, please. You can do that. And as we get the messages, we analyze them right here in the studio. Well, we also looking at this very challenging issue. Governor Gordon Obaseki sworn in November 12 last year. And till now, we have about 106 days in office. And looking at the challenge of not being able to form a cabinet for now, an executive cabinet, issues are arising, tongues are wagging over all of this challenge. And some do say, well, it's a difficult thing for democracy if the elected officer, sworn in officer, is not hitting the ground running forming his cabinet as the chief executive of the state or of the federation. But as it applies now to the Edo State Governor Gordon Obaseki, what do you make of this, Ebosele Okifo?
Well, I feel that he was sworn in on the 8th of November, you know.
On the 12th.
On the 12th of November, beg your pardon, for a second term in office. And he said he's going to form his cabinet early this year. That's what he said, you know. So I expect that by now he should be putting finishing touches to those
by now putting finishing touches, yes, already hitting the ground.
That's okay. That. It's already it's on ground. It's already running. That's the truth. The only thing is that there are no commissioners yet. But I feel that I'm sure. I don't know his plans, because. But I'm very sure that by now he must have been putting finishing touches to those that he wants to appoint.
Okay. Some say that. Some say that the benefit of Edo people in getting ideas, you know, multiple ideas from the cabinet, you know, seems to be missing because it now seems like running from a sole proprietorship angle.
That's what it will look like. But I'm saying that it's good for him to get it right. You understand? It's very, very important because at times when you rush, you make mistakes.
Okay.
I'm sure he's also trying to make sure that those that he's going to appoint, they are all going to be round pegs in round holes. And those in square peg in square holes, you understand? So all for the benefit of Edo people, so that at the end of the day, he will be able to deliver on the dividend of democracy as promised during the electionary campaign and all that, you understand?
Okay.
So I feel that by the time he announces the cabinet, we'll be happy with him, you understand? I feel he knows people are already raising eyebrow, you understand, saying that why all this time you have not formed your cabinet. And I'm sure he's thinking about it. I'm sure he's working about it.
Okay.
What we need to do is to give him the benefit of the doubt.
Okay.
I'm sure between now, probably by before the end of March, he will announce his cabinet.
Before the end of March, we can't say. There's no need to give it a duration. We can't say. Before the end of March is another 30 days.
I'm sure he's not unaware of this kind of situation. He's not unaware of it.
I'm sure he's working
on it.
I would like Idris Zekeri to come in.
Let's give him the benefit of the doubt.
Okay.
Well, as much as the lawyer is my elder brother, and the best I can do for this conversation is to say it as it is, so that he will even be proud of me.
Yes.
He's a mentor. There's a big challenge that a second-term governor does not know the round pegs and the square pegs in Edo State.
No, I didn't say it.
No, I'm not saying you didn't say that. This is me talking.
Are you saying that it seems to appear that way?
It appears that way, apparently. So he gave us a date, and the words of a leader are his bond, that in February is going to, before the end of February, he would have constituted his cabinet. February has not ended, but clearly there's nothing in the offing. Now, I sympathize with the governor because few weeks to the last Guba election, he left his party where he has familiar faces and familiar hands and went to a new party.
So you see, you think that's a setback?
What can best be described as a coming together of strange bedfellows?
So are you thinking that's a setback?
Yeah, it is a major setback because now trying to realign with your new party now, their ideology, their philosophy is a bit of a challenge. That's why you have not seen the cabinet.
So that seems to, in your own view,
yes,
that seems to be part of the problem. Reasonably, why this time?
I think it is not reasonably; it's unreasonably. Because before you work with any set of persons, you have to know them. So it's not quite reasonable. It's unreasonable, actually. Now, there is no excuse that in the in over 100 days in office, you still don't have a cabinet. 100 days in office, we should be talking of achievements, not cabinet. Achievement, where and where you have done certain things to certain persons and to certain areas to make it better. That is not even, nobody's talking about achievement. Now we are still talking about cabinet. Now don't forget that we have a State House of Assembly that is not fully constituted.
Yeah.
So for someone, I said fully, not legally. Yeah. So for someone
so
like
there
me,
are still lapses there.
Yes, for someone like me now. Yes, there are there, of course there are. For someone like me, where I come from, I don't have a representative in the State House of Assembly. Mm. And again, constitutionally, I ought to, my local government ought to have a commissioner in the State Executive Council. I do not have that. Okay. 100 days into the second term. It then means that whatever opinion, whatever mindset, whatever hues and cries that come from my local government will go on head, because the governor is not omnipotent. It cannot be everywhere at the same time. So my suggestion is to the governor, take immediate and urgent steps for the interest of Edo people to constitute a valid cabinet, so that we have one commissioner at least representing one of each of the 18 local governments of Edo State. That's my opinion.
Well, he said some contributions.
I will align myself with him. Let him announce his commissioners so that at least you have a representative. But the other issue that is representative at the House of Assembly, he doesn't have a representative at the House of Assembly. The person to hold responsible for that is the person you elected and he chose to follow another line of action. You know, at a point, we were pleading with all of them. Even in this studio, we are pleading with them severally. That those that were elected, those legislators that were elected, that choose to go to Abuja and go and be holding meetings and felt that they were holding the state government to ransom, the state moved on. You understand? We have moved on. So it's your representative that was elected, and he did not consider the people that elected him. Okay. Instead, he was giving his allegiance to a single person that was detected to him. That was detected to him.
Okay.
What he will do or not, and he stayed out to the point that a law court gave an order that your the put themselves out of the assembly. So you cannot blame them. So it's there. It went to court. The matter went to court, and court said yes, because the constitution. Constitutionally, you have a number of days you are supposed to sit as a legislator. They didn't sit like that, and those in charge of the House Assembly went to court to say that we have declared their seat vacant. I think what we should be talking about is to conduct by elections for those seats. So
okay,
that you
because
have,
there are lapses.
Yes, so that you have
and
somebody. You
that,
have somebody.
That is not the way to go.
So that my friend here okay. can have somebody that will now represent him, that will not be taking instruction from a godfather somewhere and abandon those that voted for him to be in that place.
Okay,
that's
so
the problem we're having.
We are digressing to this aspect, which is part of governance.
Yes,
also.
To add voice, I think the governor's background from the private sector, boardroom meetings, has in a way it shows in his style of governance. The governor clearly is more comfortable working with consultants and people who are non-state actors.
But the job is going on.
Yeah, well, the
projects are ongoing.
To what extent we are yet to determine, and whether the projects are going on or not is a discussion for another day. So when you call us to come and discuss what is going on and what is not, then I'll be prepared to tell you what is not.
No, a good example is the drainages.
The and drainages.
Even the aspect of the stormwater project, the government
we are going to
was a ploy to defraud
we are coming
people
to the storm,
by the previous government.
We are coming to the stormwater project. When we get there, we will exactly lay the facts bare.
We are
so we have what I can refer
yes,
to in a do state
called
Zontantocracy. Government of consultant for consulting by consultants. So that's the challenge we have. The governor should learn to work more with individuals, with the political establishment, with the state actors than non-state actors in the form of consultants.
Okay, but what matters to you, Zachary? Mm. The job is done. No matter how all the means that is being deployed, but the job is done.
There is a legal way for the job.
He follows a tactical plan that will suit the politicians or the political circle.
You just made a mention about the stormwater project. That the cry in Benin today is that the stormwater project should be completed. And you heard it in the governor's last statement, where he expressed a lot of reservations,
yeah,
even when it was part and parcel of those who
not just reservations, disappointment.
Yeah, but we'll
that disappointment because the project is not even meeting up.
Don't forget that the
and
governor,
that's why the governor is trying to create another leeway.
Don't forget
that could take lesser amount and do the job better.
No, of course not. Look, we are in Benin. Rainy season invite us here. In fact, one of the biggest prayers now is that rainy season should not start again. In due respect to our farmers, when it starts raining, we will see what this city will turn into.
So, I'm to not you, the stormwater project has been done or started by the
No, the governor has been governor
on a good note.
Of course, in fact, there are completed areas that I can mention. The governor has been governor for 5 years now. This is his fifth year in office as governor. If in 5 years you are just realizing that certain things were not done the way they ought to be done, it means you don't even know what you are doing in the office in the first place. There are a lot of places that were completed in the previous administration without speaking for them. There's Upper Lawani is there for everybody to see. Everybody knows what Five Junction used to be. Everybody knows what Igbinadua used to be. Everybody knows what Siloko Road used to be. Everybody knows what Teacher's House used to be. Everybody knows what Upper Mission used to be. Today, those areas have been completely cleared of erosion and there is watershed in it. In fact, the challenge they are having now is that God...
Will you be right to say completely?
Of course. You go to Lawani Street, you see for yourself. Lawani Street is there for everybody to see. Drive down.
What about the Five Junction access?
Like of when course, it there is gutter.
When
there,
it reinforced.
Now, when it rains now,
easily recede.
It's supposed to recede immediately, but there is sand in the gutter. It is the job of government subsequently to clear those sand.
So you can't say completely?
Look, of course it is complete.
Okay.
Maintenance is the culture here. You have a car and you put it on the road every day and you don't put oil in it. You expect not to knock. You are joking with the car. Look at Ugbowo Lagos Road, for example. We have been crying sand on the gutter. Evacuate those sand so that when it rains, the water can go. Nobody is listening. It's like the government.
Okay, you've articulated your point enough. Still. Okay, let's get your viewpoint in this direction.
Ugbowo Lagos Road, is it a state road or a federal road?
There's a state.
Is it a federal road?
It's a major road.
Ugbowo Lagos Road is a federal road. We are in this state where you had federal road that went bad. That what did Oshomola do then? He put a signboard there that please forgive me. This is federal road. It's not our road. You understand? Why are you blaming Obaseki now? The man has tried. What was the point in Secretariat building before? What was the situation? What was the situation in the High Court? We all see what the governor is doing. We all see what he has done in the civil service. We have all seen what he did with the training institute along Gabriel Sawaru way there in GRA. We have seen so many things he has also done. You understand? Now the water storm something was a disaster. You cannot blame it on this present government. The reason being that when Oshomola was there as governor, he was in charge. Godo Obaseki was only the head of the economic team. Oshomola even said it himself. What does he do? Initiate the program and Obaseki helps him to source for money for him to do it.
Okay,
you cannot be blaming Obaseki for the fault of the Waterstorm project. You cannot. Because he was not in charge.
In a position where this project kickstarted,
yes,
and he was the head of the economic team.
Yes.
Ideally, as expected,
yes,
what should have been his position?
No, the issue was
in terms of his disappointment at that time.
His work was well cut out for him. We were all in this state. We knew the kind of person Oshomola was as a governor for 8 years. We knew the way he was busy going about implementing policies and all that. Those that he appointed were just there as figureheads. They had no say. That's the truth.
That is true.
They had no say. As the head of the economic team.
That means they were pretentious. In terms of the faces they were putting up.
Let me tell you. Obaseki was the head of the economic team. Oshomola said it himself. Obaseki, what Oshomola does is to say, I want to do this. Obaseki goes out to source for money for him. Those words came from Oshomole. That's what he said.
Is it right to source for Obaseki when you feel the project is not ideal? What were you expecting Obaseki to do at that point?
He wasn't a commissioner. He was just a head of the economic team. His job was to look for the money. They do the project. It was not. Was it the commissioner for works? For Christ's sake, was it the commissioner for environment? You understand? His hands were tied as at when he was there with Oshobole.
Okay.
So he's dead now, and he has seen this disaster. And you cannot blame him for crying out. You know, we all know what is happening in Imo State today now. How Uzodima has seized the estate that Okorocha used Imo, that he fed, used Imo citizens' money to build. He has seized it. It's not even happening here. Some of us are not happy that even the state government is not doing something about some of these elephant projects.
Some stakeholders are saying,
tell us what they did with the money. 30 billion.
Okay, yes. What some critics some critics are saying, how do we follow this probe? Like he said, he's going to kickstart. How do we follow this probe to a logical conclusion where it gets to that point?
Yeah, it should set up a
where names can be mentioned.
Yeah, it should set
where,
up
where they will be prosecuted. Do you think it will get to that point?
It might get to that because if he now sees that, imagine taking 30 billion of the state's money to say you are doing a water stone project, yet rain comes and we start running heta sheta. You understand? Rain comes, we are looking for where to put our heads. So many landlords have returned to squatters and have returned to tenants because you started a project, you could not do anything what you were supposed to do. Yet you took 30 billion out. Okay. And you expect anybody that is the governor to be happy?
The number to call, happy. Thank you. The number to call is 0529 0573. If I'm correct. Okay. The number there, 0522905573. It's on the screen for viewers on independent television. And of course, for those on radio, please get the number and start pouring your calls at us. This says, from the WhatsApp message, this is a WhatsApp message, I mean. This says, my name is Desmond Uyi Enigie. The problem of Nigeria security from FEDRA is from FEDRA and not state.
Yes.
And that's what Uyi Enigie said. The problem of security is from the FEDRA and not the state. And this says, good morning, presenter. I am Chas from Benin. No government can tackle insecurity without first tackling unemployment. This just raised a vital point because if you look at unemployment, it goes a long way to come up with all of this menace. He said, good morning to you all in the studio. My contributions to the issue on the ground today is for our government to be sincere. I'm expecting that your name is at the bottom. It's for our government to be sincere in their approach to security issues. In this country, people are being killed and wasted every day. Okay, from Apostle Dixon Ugiagbe in Ugbioko. All right, so we got this one again. Your comment, you said, good morning, Richmond Enobakai from Benin. When I keep hearing the government making negotiations with terrorists and bandits, I wonder if they don't have collaborations with the terrorists, because doing so automatically encourage more youths into terrorism. Why can't we have a good government for once in our lives? Well, I want you to react to that, Zachary.
Well, you can see the tone of the conversation from our text messages. Truth be told, you cannot really tackle insecurity without tackling unemployment. Okay, so except those kind of insecurity that are ideologically driven, like the one we had with the Boko Haram insurgency.
That's what I'm having.
And the cattle rustlers, and now we're having with the Fulani bandits. So we continue to encourage our people, especially in Northern Nigeria. Our governors, I hope they will listen to
you. Okay, I think I'll stop you there. We have a caller. Good morning, caller. Tell us your name and where are you calling from?
Yeah, my name is Comrade Abbey. I'm calling from Benin.
Comrade Abbey from Benin.
Yeah, sure. The issue of the water stone project is just unfortunate that we don't say the truth. The past government, what they did was absolutely wrong. When it rains, everywhere will be flooded. So for the current governor to take it upon himself that they have to do it and let them prove it. 30 billion is not 1 billion. So I think they should look into it. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Comrade Abbey. Well, we're getting more calls, and as your call come in, please ensure you are civil in your presentation. Good morning, caller. Tell us your name, where you're calling from, and kickstart your contribution.
Good morning, it's David. I'm calling from Benin.
Your name again?
I said, this is David. I'm calling from Benin.
Hey, David. Okay, go ahead, David.
So, for the probing aspect, there's no link. We need development. You don't need to probe. Because the central hospital, they're telling us they want to probe that, but we never... You know,
never saw the light of the day.
So, I think coming up with another one, I think is a waste of time.
Thank you.
For the security aspect, let them move these cattle headers, let them move them to the highways so that they will occupy the both sides of the highway. So, anyone that needs to buy from them will go there and patronize them. So that they will keep the highway busy.
You mean the cattle herders should be on the highway? Is that what you're saying? Would they not constitute another problem? Well, thank you, David.
As funny as that sounds.
You have to use them, get them.
Okay.
You know?
Thank you, David. You've articulated your point. Noted.
You have to use them.
Okay. Thank you, David. Well, he just made comments concerning projects like the specialist hospital, like he did say, planned probe that didn't see the light of the day, like in his own words. What do you make of that? Because he's advising that, for that sake, there shouldn't be another probe.
I would disagree with him a little bit.
Pessimistic.
A little bit.
Okay.
As diversionary and as distractionary as the probe is by the governor, I think you should go ahead with it. My late mother would say, if you throw a stone into the market, it will either meet your sister or your mother. And that is what they are doing. He's throwing a stone into the market. And when he throws it, he will now remember that his company, AfriInvest, was one that sourced for the 30 billion loan and got 5%. He will also remember
let's take this call.
Cabinet were in that cabinet.
Hello, we have someone on the line.
Good morning.
This must be Sonny from Airport Road.
Well, President, this is Sonny, but I'm calling you from Forestry Road.
From Forestry Road. Okay, that's a good one.
Thank you very much.
Okay, go ahead with your contribution.
I wish the issue of this blame game would stop. If you look at it, I heard all of their learners, all of us are educated. He said that when the governor came here this second term, he said he's going to consider the program. He said in February. He didn't say in the later. He said in February he's going to constitute. And I think that when you talk about the issue of proof, it is not a big deal. It is because of the failure of leadership, and because we actually do not know what we are doing when it comes to governance. That's what we are talking about. The governor wants to prove. If the institution of governance, the institution of government, they're actually working, they should be the one proving. Because as far as it's public fund, anybody that takes one error, it may take 10 years or 20 years, the person will account for it. So it doesn't matter, and that should not disturb the governor. He should be able to continue with his work and focus on his promises to the people. But unfortunately, during the campaign, everything he played about Shomole was, he was the reason why Shomole succeeded. I can't imagine why the lawyer would say that. The reason he was just there figuring. Are you saying that the commissioner there is not the SSG? Was not there then, and he said they were just quiet.
Many of them.
That should, and when he also leaves office tomorrow, people that are working with us now will also begin to say they were quiet. We can't do blame game. Governor's come, governor will go. And the state remains. So what we need to do is to collect the rod, because the former governor did not do well, that is why he's here. This is not to start blaming the former governor, is to put a sort to ensure that there's no recurrence in going forward.
Thank you, Sonny. Well, he said the blame game should stop and look forward to making governance better for it. Well, as we round off, summing up, you had a floor while we took that.
As I said, finish up on your point. In Obaseki's administration today, the key players were also the key players in the same administration, removing only the governor. The deputy governor today was majority leader that approved that law in the State House of Assembly. The deputy governor today, Comrade Philip Shaibu. The governor today was chairman economic team, and his company, AfriInvest, sourced the 30 billion loan and got 5%. He's the chairman of Edo GIS was commissioner for the SSG was commissioner for works. The present SSG, Osarojion Ogie.
several of them. Inegbeje was commissioner for finance.
Okay, let's take this last call.
So you cannot remove it. You cannot separate
let's
the
take
mother
this last
from
call.
The baby.
Hello, good morning, caller.
Hello, good morning. My name is Solomon Ijogbe.
Solomon Ijogbe.
Yes, Ijogbe, my name.
Go ahead. Good morning.
I first on the issue of security or insecurity in this country, it starts from the top. It's a sign of institutional failure. The issue of insecurity is not an issue of the IGP or the Minister for Defense or for the head of the military. It is about the institution because over time, the Nigerian state has succeeded in building stronger individuals, stronger persons against strong institutions. One man can order the head of any security agency and give him order. That's the problem. When people become stronger than institutions, that's all. And then on the issue of the water supply, the carrier has said it all. The man who is the government today was described as the angel root of Adams Osomolo's government. And that was even his campaign match against the half election because he was displaying the jingle that was played for him in the previous election. The institutional work at the then was is the current SSD. The deputy governor today was the same person who was in the upper assembly. That is
what does that excuse. Why did they do it? Why should they do it? What has to happen?
And God do not. After King, if you go and look at his inaugural speech, congratulated the then governor that was leading and handing over to him. I said, we're going to continue. And the water tank project was their major continuity project. So I don't see why we start doing blame game now.
Thank you, Solomon Ijogbe.
I'm coming. I was taking advantage of the photo of the minister for what we call national planning being paraded as one of those who put the money, but it's evident. And I quickly replied, let's solve this blue game. Let's ask all of those. We as two people were interested in what happened to the 30 billion naira water sub project. So let's not leave any stone unturned. Let's get all those dramatic.
Thank you. Thank you, Solomon Ijogbe. You made your point, and I think it's up to you now, okay, to react to the statements made. I believe you had some issues that you want to try.
Yes, the issue is that, first of all, it doesn't. It's no excuse that because the governor was head of the economic team, his company, Afro Invest, went to source for the money and all that. He took 5%. Of course, he took 5% because he sourced for that money. So what to do with the money is not, it does not stop at his table. You understand? You cannot be blaming him now that because he sourced for the money, then he should have ensured. What were you expecting him to do? The governor was there. The governor got the 30 billion naira, and the governor started the Waterstone project. I believe that he should have make sure that the project was properly done,
okay,
and not throwing those states into a problem now,
okay,
because of the undone work. You understand? Like, we are also aware that President Buhari is going to the sixth year now out of his eight-year tenure that he's going to have. We were aware of how various promises that were made during 2015 when he was coming in. Somebody said that any government, like Minister Fashola said, any government that cannot provide 24 hours light within 6 months has no business there. And that if they come in and are able to give Nigerians light for 24 hours, they should be stoned.
Okay, where is thank
the
light you.
Now? We're still suffering it.
Thank you, thank you. Thank you. I think that's your round of points.
You understand? So
that's
you cannot be blaming
thank
the
you.
Governor just because he said,
thank
I'm
you.
Going to set up my cabinet in February and he's unable to do it.
Thank you, Abosele Okifo. You've made your point clear.
The other thing is that he should do it right.
You've made your point clear.
It's up
to you now.
In the final analysis, I want to encourage the governor to get serious about governance and to make sure that he builds on the legacies that his predecessor left. Very envious legacy, very achievable, very commendable legacies of his people. Look, no matter how you hate Adams Oshomole, he did a few things, a lot of things he did them right. And this governor promised.
No. You said he did a few things, a lot of things.
Yes,
which one do you want to say?
A lot of things, right?
Okay, a lot of things.
And he should continue on those legacies. One of those legacies is the stormwater project. Edo people will not listen to excuses when the rain starts later this year. We will not listen to excuses.
So the rain is the litmus test.
Yes, the rain will show whether you are a governor or you are not a governor.
Thank you. A big thanks, Zachary Idris, for taking our time.
Thank you
out
so
of
much.
Your busy schedule. And of course, to Ebusel Okifo.
Thank you very
big thanks, and once again, congratulations on your new office.
Thank you very
congratulations.
Much. Thank you.
Well, this is what you can take. Big thanks to those who contributed on via the WhatsApp platform. Enigie, I didn't get your name rightly, but thanks for all those contributions. And also to Comrade Abbey, who called us, and also to David and Sonny from Forestry called us, and also Solomon Ijube. Big thanks. For those who tried calling us but we were not able to pick, don't worry. Next week will be another time. And I want to say a big thanks to our listeners on Independent Radio and viewers on Independent Television. Till we come your way again, same time next week. My name remains Philip Omo Gupo. Goodbye.